Go.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jacob Scott, and my presentation will be on stable isotopes. All right, so I'm going to give you a brief outline on what we're going to cover. We're going to start with a general overview of isotopes, and give you the basic terms. Then I'm going to move on to how we measure them, the different devices we use, and how they work. And then I'm going to give you uses of today's work, which is like why we need to learn about it, why it's going to be useful if you have a better knowledge of it. Then I'm going to finish up with a short summary. And any questions if you guys have it. So, some general information on isotopes. An isotope is varying for elements. An isotope is when you have a different amount of neutrons present at the nuclei of an atom of an element, which can be confusing if you hear those terms. So an atom of conviction, which you think will be easy. So carbon, there are three main isotopes that you're going to deal with. You have carbon-12, carbon-13, and carbon-14. In carbon-12, you're going to have 6 protons and 6 neutrons, which add up to give you the 12. Carbon-13, 6 protons, 7 neutrons. Carbon-14, 6 protons, and 8 neutrons. So it's the varying amount of neutrons that give you the different isotopes. The next point I'm going to make is what makes them stable or unstable. This varies for each element. It's the interactions that occur between the interatomic forces, the bonds between these protons and neutrons. So you're going to have different numbers that are stable for different elements. So carbon 12 and 13 are both considered stable isotopes. Carbon 14 is considered a radioactive isotope and decay over time, attempting to become stable. However, oxygen 16, isotope 16 and isotope 18 are both stable. So you can see that the number doesn't always correlate with what's stable, what's not stable. It can increase or decrease depending on where you're at and if you're at the table. The next thing we're going to look at some commonly used isotopes you find in, say, biology or various sciences such as geology. You're going to use carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, oxygen, hydrogen, things you would find in organisms or, say, a rock. Fractionation is what we use to measure. This is why this is the process that makes isotopes so valuable to us. Fractionation is the separation of these isotopes through processes, some being physical, some being chemical. So an example of this is evaporation. Let's say you have a certain amount of water at the equator. When this evaporates, the lighter isotope, oxygen 16 in this case, H2O, the oxygen, which is what we track. The oxygen 16 isotope is lighter than the oxygen 18. There are less neutrons there, it weighs a little bit less. So it's going to want to evaporate first. However, during evaporation, both oxygen 16 and 18 do evaporate. Once it reaches a certain level of the atmosphere, it starts to condense. At this point, it starts to lose more oxygen 18 than 16. Oxygen 18 that is absorbed in the clouds, it's heavier, so it's going to want to leave first. So as this water travels from, say, the tropics further north, you're going to lose more oxygen 18. You're going to have a higher amount of oxygen 16 present in the rain and clouds. So when you get to the poles, you're going to have the largest amount of oxygen 16 present, and the lightest water, the lightest ice present at the poles. Next, I'm going to tell you all about a mass spectrometer. This is the device we use to measure fractionation. So at the front end of your mass spectrometer, that's where you inject your sample of whatever you're measuring. Let's say carbon in this case. So your carbon sample goes in here in gaseous form. Right here, this heating device is coiled metal. That's extremely high, firing electrons off. This bar up here has a positive charge which attracts these electrons. So when the carbon sample comes in here, these electrons being fired off this beam hit the electrons in your sample, knocking them off, giving your sample a positive charge. circles of metal have positive charge as well, which repels the positive charge of your sample, creating an acceleration to fire your sample at the other end. Now, since these isotopes have different weights, they're going to be interacted differently by magnetic force. This magnetic field is here. It's going to cause your ion trails to end up in different locations. A lighter ion is going to be affected more by magnetic field, and your isotope is going to have less of an effect, so it's going to go a more direct path. For carbon, we would normally have carbon isotopes 12, 13, 14. 12 is normally going to be towards the middle, and 14, although this picture shows everything being collected by your detector at the end, most of the time you're going to have stuff going off the sides here, here, and here. So you're going to want to adjust your magnetic field, bring the magnets closer, you're going to have a heavier effect on the trail, so you'll be able to read those heavier isotopes. This is another device for measuring isotopes. This one has a much more complicated name than the mass spectrometer, although it does something a little bit simpler. This is a wavelength scan cavity and ring down spectrometer. Sounds amazingly complicated, but it does something really simple. So if you picture an isotope as a little particle of dust, you shine a light through it, it's going to absorb a part of that light. Ions or isotopes do the same thing. The diode laser that you shine in sends a small amount of infrared light, which isotopes have the ability to absorb. These isotopes interact with the light and take up a part of the light. So at the end, after it's reflected through a bunch of times by these mirrors, at the mirror end, a certain amount of that light will no longer be present since it has interacted with these isotopes. At the end, have this mirror, they help to focus the beam out of this jumbled mess that you see back into a singular beam. This beam is then taken up by the detector at the end, and the percentage of light that's been taken up by these isotopes in your machine will give you a ratio of what isotopes are present. Again, you have to put them in the gas state to get them in this machine, which is one of the reasons why it's lightly more than it can only take gaseous samples. And now on some uses that we have for isotopes in today's society, why all this is useful now that you know how to measure them, what they are, these are why we use them. Agriculture is one of the biggest uses, it's where we get our food from. Because we know all this information on isotopes, now create higher yields of food to get better products. So for fertilizing crops, nitrogen is a key element in the fertilizer. We want to be able to get the most fertilizer into our plants. We don't want this leaving in runoff. We don't want it staying in soil. We don't want it to evaporate. So we want to make sure the plant is taking up as much as physically possible. So in a controlled setting, tanks. We can take samples of the air, of the soil, using mass spectrometers, find out what ratio of this fertilizer is where. We can figure out how much is the plant, how much is the air, how much is the water that's being put in. From that, we can see what ratio is actually being taken up by the plant. So by using mass spectrometer, we can figure out which isotope of, say, nitrogen we want. It's all evaporating in the air, we want a heavier isotope. So we can compensate for that. We have the ability to use different levels of isotopes in our fertilizers. Another key use for isotopes is radiometric dating, which is carbon dating. That's kind of carbon dating, that kind of carbon dating. You can see how old certain things are. We can track the ages of fossils, of plants, of things such as pots, pans. You tell how old these elements are by evaluating the ratio of certain isotopes in them. For this skeleton right here, we would use carbon data, we would use radiometric data, we would use uranium-238, which has a radioactive element that would have like roughly 4.5 billion years. But for carbon, the half-life is about 5,730 years. So we can get a rough estimate all the way back to about 62,000 years. Carbon-14 is a radioactive element that's made up in the upper atmosphere and cosmic rays hit nitrogen isotopes. Knock a neutron off, you get carbon-14. That's taken in the plants for photosynthesis. And if you eat these plants, you get a certain amount of carbon-14 into our bodies. When we die, we stop taking in carbon-14. It starts to decay, and then we contract that rate in this thing through fractionation. Another way we can use it is global temperatures. We can track these temperatures over a certain amount of time by using plankton. Plankton found at the surface of our oceans absorbs a certain amount of oxygen and carbon dioxide. As you know, if you're a marine science major, the ocean is a huge sink for carbon dioxide. So these plankton in the surface of the ocean take in certain amount of ratios of these elements. When they die, they sink to the bottom. Now, as Brad commented in his presentation, there's a bunch of sediments on the floor. You can take a coring sample of these sediments. It goes down in many, many feet, and the samples are, I think, upwards of 30 feet in length. You can see all these different levels. Now, by using radiometric dating on the soil around this plankton, you can see how old these samples are. And then by taking samples of oxygen, carbon in these plankton, we can correlate that to a certain temperature. We've done controlled studies with temperature and mollusks to see the ratio of oxygen at different temperatures. And it's a very linear correlation that we've drawn for these ratios to the temperatures that we were subjected to. We can also use this to see if cycle elements through any given ecosystem. Things such as hydrogen, carbon in the atmosphere, how that's circulating, where it's gone, where it's been through these chemical processes or physical processes it's undergone. Which is why fractionation is such an important concept when it comes to the study of isotopes. So, in summation, isotopes, some key points I want to really take away. Isotopes are atoms of an element. Different amount of neutrons. It's going to vary from element to element. We have one heavy one, one light one, and a radioactive one. So those are the three that we find important. Radioactive one, we can study half-lives, decay rates. Heavy one, we can use in various chemical processes. Heavier ones are normally the rate-limiting ones. So if you're doing a chemical analysis, any sort of reaction. The lighter one is going to go first in cases of many physical changes. The heavier one is going to normally go second because of its greater density. Fractionation is a great process. It's why we can measure isotopes. This is what makes isotopes so useful. It's a separation of these isotopes through these different changes, be it a physical change or a chemical change. Mass spectrometer, the wavelength scan, how do you bring down to the trust of the machine, these tools that we use to measure this fractionation. These are what make fractionation a measurable thing and allow us to correlate them with things such as time or temperature. And the applications